I know. Yeah. We don't go to the hospital to rest. Exactly. And that's not better.
Good afternoon. Today we celebrate the second Sunday of Ordinary Time. We now enter the season of Ordinary Time until the beginning of Lent on February 17. This month of Ordinary Time gives us a brief respite from the major seasons of Advent, Christmas and Lent, Easter. Today's first reading is about the call of Samuel, the prophet, and the gospel presents to us the call of the first disciples of Jesus. These two readings remind us that we too are called to follow the Lord and to respond as Samuel did. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. Please remember to silence your cell phones so that we can worship God without destruction. Thank you. The celebrant for this Mass and the preacher is Father Francis.
Holy Spirit, amen. The grace and the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Here I am, Lord. I come to do your will. As we enter into the mystery of God's call to us and our response, the disciples follow Jesus. And he says, what do you want? What are you looking for? An important question for them. And they answer it very carefully. Where do you stay, Rabbi? So my beloved brothers and sisters, let us enter now into this sacred time as we call to mind our sins. Lord Jesus, you are the Word through whom all things are made. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You are the light of those sitting in darkness. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
And you are the light of the world. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you are
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, who govern all things, both in heaven and on earth, mercifully hear the pleading of your people and bestow your peace on our times. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A reading from the first book of Samuel. Samuel was sleeping in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. The Lord called to Samuel, who answered, "Here I am." Samuel ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." "I did not call you," Eli said. "Go back to sleep." So he went back to sleep. Again the Lord called Samuel, who rose and went to Eli. "Here I am," he said, "you called me." But Eli answered, "I did not call you, my son. Go back to sleep." At that time, Samuel was not familiar with the Lord because the Lord had not revealed anything to him as yet. The Lord called Samuel again for the third time. Getting up and going to Eli, he said, "Here I am, you called me." Then Eli understood that the Lord was calling the youth. So he said to Samuel, "Go to sleep, and if you are called, reply, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" When Samuel went to sleep in his place, the Lord came and revealed his presence, calling out as before, "Samuel, Samuel." Samuel answered, "Speak, for your servant is listening." Samuel grew up, and the Lord was with him, not permitting any word of his to be without effect. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Here I am.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, the body is not for immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord is for the body. God raised the Lord and will also raise us by his power. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? But whoever is joined to the Lord becomes one spirit with him. Avoid immorality. Every other sin a person commits is outside the body, but the immoral person sins against his own body. Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God, and that you are not your own? For you have been purchased at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. John was standing with two of his disciples, and as he watched Jesus walk by, he said, "Behold the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard what he said and followed Jesus. Jesus turned and saw them following him and said to them, "What are you looking for?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher, "where are you staying?" He said to them, "Come and you will see." So they went and saw where Jesus was staying, and they stayed with him that day. It was about 4 in the afternoon. Andrew, the brother of Simon Peter, was one of the two who heard John and followed Jesus. He first found his own brother Simon and told him, "We have found the Messiah," which translated means Christ. Then they brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, the son of John. You will be called Cephas," which is translated Peter. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. We heard the call of God in the book of Samuel. We heard how the little boy, whose name is Samuel, and the book is named after him, the book of Samuel, he hears God call, and he didn't know who it was who was calling him. So he said, "Who are you?" And he runs thinking it's Eli, his teacher. And Eli, his teacher, is an old man, and he was asleep.
It says, I did not call you. Get back to sleep. Then the Lord called Samuel a second time. And again, he went to his teacher. Here I am. You called me. But Eli, the old man, the old priest, said, I did not call you, my son. Go back to sleep. So the third time, God calls Samuel again. Now, the book of Samuel makes us realize that Samuel was not yet familiar with the Lord. He was too young. But getting up this third time, he goes to Eli, and Eli now is prepared for this. He understood that the Lord was calling the youth. So he said to Samuel, go to sleep, and if you are called, reply, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. So when Samuel went to sleep in the palace, back at his place, the Lord came and revealed his presence, calling out before Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel said, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. The call to Samuel, who will be an important prophet. Now, the gospel today, the gospel comes from the first chapter of St. John. We're reading during cycle B, mostly from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. But as you've heard, and maybe you've read the book of Matthew, the gospel according to Matthew, it's the shortest of all the gospels. So how are we going to stretch it out over all the weeks, the 33 weeks, not counting Advent and Lent and Christmas and Easter? How are we going to stretch it out over the other 33 weeks? We use heavy portions of St. John, and we're very fortunate because the Holy Gospel according to St. John gives us a new understanding of who is this Jesus. In the Holy Gospel according to John, the language is more stately. In St. Mark, it's more immediate and quick, but in St. John, it's more stately. And he introduces us to who Jesus is, and then to distinguish him from John the Baptist. This must have been a really important thing for him to do, because as soon as he starts to talk about who Jesus is, then he starts to compare him with John the Baptist. John the Baptist, who is not even worthy to unfasten the strap on his sandals. St. John tells us, I must decrease and he must increase. St. John says, someone is coming after me who is greater than I am. And so in the section of this first chapter of St. John's Gospel, St. John has been preaching to the people, and he's preaching to the people along the banks of the River Jordan. And he tells to them, when he sees Jesus, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And he announces it to the people when Jesus comes. And Jesus comes to be baptized, not because he needs it, but because we need it. He comes not because he's a sinner, but because he came to save sinners. He comes not because he has sins, but because he comes down to do the Father's will, which is to stand shoulder to shoulder with sinners where sinners are. Not from heaven, but not in heaven, but down and on earth. So today we hear the gospel where John once again announces that Jesus is the Lamb of God. But this time he's not announcing it to the crowds. He's announcing it to a couple of his disciples. So, it gets a little confusing when you hear John and it's the Holy Gospel according to John, but you understand that the John that is baptizing Jesus is a different John than the one who wrote the Gospel. So John the Baptist, he's the one standing with two of his disciples. And as he watched Jesus walk by, he said, to his disciples, "Behold the Lamb of God." So these disciples of St. John, they go after Jesus. And here is how this language in St. John works. They followed Jesus. Jesus turns, he saw them, he looks at them, and then he speaks to them. And the question that he asks them is a very probing question. Remember God in the Garden of Eden when Adam and Eve had sinned and they go and hide themselves? Why did they hide themselves from God in the Garden of Eden? Because they had sinned and they realized they were naked and that, you know, they had shame over their nakedness. And God calls them and asks them a question. Where are you? Now, that doesn't mean where are you? He knows where they are. But, you know, between your first breath when you were born and your existence began and your last breath when your earthly existence is over, where are you in this lifeline of your life? Are you coming? Are you on the path to me or are you not? And so Jesus asks these apostles a question similar to when God said to Adam and Eve, "Where are you?" Now he says to these disciples, "What are you looking for?" And that's an important question to us. It's like an exam. What am I looking for? Well, you know what it's like when you start looking for your car keys, or when you start looking for your wallet, or you're looking for your glasses. Where are my glasses? You're wearing them. Oh, yeah. You know, we go crazy sometimes trying to find those things that we can't do without. What are you looking for? Well, on the bigger question, you know, I want a good life. I want to not have too many enemies. And if I have any enemies, I want to be able to find another place to live, or suggest that they move someplace else. I don't know. When the priests, when we Dominicans, and also the diocesan priests do it this way too. I only know from our way, the provincial asks, "What is it that you seek? What do you seek?" And the answer that we give them, that we give the provincial, is God's mercy and yours. Now, that's a very interesting answer. You know, we could have said, because we're lying down prostrate, "Where's the nearest exit? Let me get out of here." Or we may be saying, "Can you guarantee me a nice job for the rest of my life?" I mean, we might have questions like that, but the answer is a bigger statement: God's mercy and yours. So Jesus asks these two disciples, who so far we haven't heard their names yet, "What are you looking for?" His look is probing and he sees more than what he lets on. And so he asks a question that's going to be perfect for them. He wants to know, "Are you ready to follow me? Are you are you following me out of curiosity, or what are you doing?" And so they have to answer. He already knows, but he has to ask them. They said to him, "Rabbi, where are you staying?" That's a good answer. "Rabbi, where are you staying?" Do they have any idea that they are speaking to the one whose true home is one with the Father before all things came to be? The Word who was with God and the Word who was God. The Word through whom all things were made. Jesus has a lot of answers for their question. But he simply gives them a lesson. He gives them a lesson. His lesson is this: come and you will see. That's his lesson, the whole thing. And they went and they saw. That was the whole lesson? Now that's what I'm talking about. We like short lessons, something really easy to do. And this lesson is very, very profound. So they went and saw where Jesus was staying, and they stayed with him that day. Who is this with whom they are spending the day? Let us go earlier into the chapter 1 of St. John's Gospel, where we are listening to this particular section, just a little bit later in the Gospel, towards the end. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him. Without him, not anything made that not anything was made. In him, in Jesus, was life, and the life was the light of men, of humans. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. Jesus is the true light that enlightens everyone who comes in the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. These two disciples, the one who they ask, "Where are you staying?" and they spend the day with him, the reality of who Jesus is will be too much for them. That is for later. But St. John, when the gospel writer, not the Baptist, but the gospel writer, he makes sure that we understand who it is who is inviting these disciples to come and see where he stays. Come and see. So they went and they saw. Then Andrew, who turns out is one of those two disciples, is the brother of Simon Peter. Now, Simon Peter's name at this point is just Simon, but this gospel is written where people have heard about who Peter is, so the gospel writer has to make sure that they understand that Simon has a second name that is given to him by God. There is a name you receive at birth, but then for some people in their lives, they receive a new name. And that happens in religious life too. Some people take on a new name. I didn't. I kept my baptismal name because I was named after my uncle, whose name was Francis. And so I was named after him. But a lot of other priests, some here at here in my community, they took special names from for at their religious profession. So let's listen to St. John tell us more about this Jesus. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Where do you stay? I stay among you, full of grace and truth. And from his fullness, we have all received grace upon grace. The apostles, they will later be apostles, but right now they're just beginning they're learning who Jesus is. So they're not apostles yet. They're way at the beginning of an acquaintance, and later a friendship, and later faith. It takes time for Jesus to develop this with them, the same as we too. We come to Jesus and we begin by getting to know him and then to become friends with him and finally to put our faith in him. Jesus, I trust in you. That doesn't come at the beginning, that comes as we grow into it. And St. John, he tells us that through Moses, the law came, but through Jesus Christ, grace and truth come. So next, Andrew runs to his brother, Simon Peter, and he first found his own brother Simon and told him, "We have found the Messiah." Jesus must have told them during that day together, you know, the one that all the prophets have been promising, "I am he." And then they brought Simon to Jesus. And again, Jesus looks at him, and the look of Jesus is an important action. We allow God to see us. And he said to Simon, "You are Simon, the son of John." He tells something to Simon that's about now. This is who you are now. You will be called Cephas, but later you're going to be called Cephas, which is translated Peter. Well, that's as far as the gospel tells us. And it makes us understand that when we allow Jesus to look at us and to see us, and we know that he is seeing us, and we are seeing him, first he's going to call us to a knowledge of who he is. And that's an important part of conversion, knowledge and friendship, and finally faith. There's a second part of it, though. There's a second part of being called, and that's what you're going to do. From now on, you will be fishing men. And you will be called Peter. And we're going to find out more about the significance of that name later on when Jesus is asking the disciples, "Who do the people say that I am?" But the final stage of the call is being made apostles. And that will not happen to these disciples until Pentecost. Pentecost will be a final stage which will send them out and change their lives forever. There will be no going back. The church is the church of apostles that have been sent out into the world so that the light of the world may be in the world and would be available for people. Through Moses, we got the law, but in Jesus Christ is grace and truth. And so he calls us, and we say to him, "Here I am, Lord. I come to do your will." I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son,
who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. And I look forward to the baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We have gathered today to listen to God speaking to us through his word in the scriptures. Now we speak to God from our hearts, bringing to him our needs.
For the church, especially during the week of prayer for Christian unity, that the Lord may direct and strengthen our dialogue and collaboration and lead all Christians to be one in faith, hope, and charity. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For God's blessing upon our country as we make the transition to a new presidency, may the transition be peaceful, and may our political leaders make wise and just decisions regarding the difficulties of the past weeks. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For strength and perseverance for all those who are struggling to overcome the pandemic, and for God's continued blessings upon all those who are serving and protecting us, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the protection and well-being of the unborn, immigrants, the homeless, and all who are vulnerable, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Marie Emily Klitke, for her birthday, whom we remember in a special way at this Mass, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intentions written in our book of prayer, and for all the intentions we hold in the silence of our hearts, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, we thank you for the privilege of calling us to follow you. May we continue to listen to your voice and accomplish your will in our lives. We ask this in your name, Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
He's the Lord of every season. He's the master of all time, and he's come to sow the seed today, this field of humankind. They tell the word of heaven is among us in this place. And if you have ears to listen, you can hear him call your name. He's calling out your name. He's calling out your name. If you have ears to listen, he's calling out your name. He's calling out your name. He's calling out your name. If you have ears to listen, he's calling out your name.
pray, beloved, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of God's name, for our good and the good of all this holy church.
Grant us, O Lord, we pray, that we may participate worthily in these mysteries, for whenever the memorial of this sacrifice is celebrated, the work of our redemption is accomplished through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, he humbled himself and was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross, he has freed us from unending death, and by rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts we have brought to you these gifts we pray by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, he broke the bread. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more, giving thanks, he gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The Mystery of Faith.
Until you come again.
therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity together with Francis, our Pope, and Jose, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection. And all who have died in your mercy, welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, and with Saint Joseph, her spouse, and with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
And let us turn to one another and to all of you watching on live stream. Let us turn to one another and offer the sign of the peace of Christ.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. and for spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present.
I believe that you are present
in the most holy sacrament.
In the most holy sacrament.
I love you above all things.
I love you above all things.
And I desire to receive you into my soul.
And I desire to receive you into my soul.
Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart.
Come at least spiritually into my heart.
I embrace you as if you were already there.
I embrace you as if you are already there.
And unite myself wholly to you.
And unite myself wholly to you.
Never permit me to be separated from you.
Never permit me to be separated from you.
Amen.
Amen.
I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people's cry. Oh, who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who may stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, if you lead me.
Let us pray. Pour out on us, O Lord, the spirit of your love, and in your kindness make those you have nourished by this one heavenly bread, one in mind and heart, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So the announcements, the first one I know by heart is going to be on Monday. There will be only one Mass. The one Mass is at 9 in the morning. Do you know why? Because it's Martin Luther King Day. So it's a national holiday, and the office will be closed. And so there will only be one Mass at 9 o'clock. Holy Family Parish in Glendale is having another food drive on Saturday, January 30th. There will be more information in our bulletin next week if you would like to participate. So Monday, one Mass at 9, Tuesday back to the normal schedule at 8. We would like to offer all of our parishioners a chance to pray together during difficult times in our country. So we will be having a holy hour with the Blessed Sacrament on Saturday, January 30th, it'll start at 7 p.m., so actually it'll be a couple hours after Mass. It will feature some quiet time, some music, some communal prayer, and we'll finish with benediction at about 8:30. So please join us in person or by live stream and pray for all your intentions. If you would like to be in the church for the holy hour, please register on our website at Evenbrite app. The first 100 people who register will be allowed in. And at the end of the bulletin that you take home with you, or if you are watching from home and you can download the Mass packet, Father Roberto has a message about how we can grow spiritually even in dark times like these. And thank you very much to Rudy and to Debbie for the music today. The Lord be with you.
And with your
spirit. The peace and the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit descend upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
I am the light of the world, says the Lord. They who follow me will have the light of life. Arise, says the Lord, have no fear within you, for in my presence there will be no darkness. I am the light of the world. I am the light of the world, says the Lord. They who follow me will have the light of life.